To welcome Max Alexeyev from the University of South Carolina. He's going to talk about the reconstruction of ancestral sequences.
Thank you for the opportunity to present my talk here. I will talk about reconstruction of ancestral genomes and presence of gene loss. So genome rearrangements are evolution events that shuffle genomic material without altering it otherwise. And since large-scale genome rearrangements are rare events, they can be used to measure distance, evolution distance between two genomes. And then this gives rise to distance-based methods for reconstruction of ancestral genomes. But before going into this, let me remind background about rearrangement analysis of two genomes. If you have two unichromosomal genomes, then the only rearrangement we have is reversal or inversion. And as soon as we have two genomes, we can define reversal distance as a minimal number of operations between two genomes. And first polynomial time algorithm for finding reversal distance between two genomes was proposed by Hanhal and Pevsner in 1995. Then later, then the same year, we extended the algorithm to computing genomic distance that include more rearrangement operations on multi-chromosomal genomes, such as translocations, fissions, and fusions. Both these developments were subject to many, many improvements, but still the model is rather complicated, and recently most studies are using a simpler model known as double cut and join operations, but I prefer a different name to break rearrangement operations since for me it's just a particular case of multi-break rearrangements. So let me, for simplicity, assume that our chromosomes are our genomes contain circular chromosomes, and I represent each chromosome as a cycle. For example, if you have chromosomes on four genes, A, B, C, and D, then we can represent it as a cycle which contains four red-directed edges, which encodes the genes and their direction, as well as four undirected edges that encode adjacencies between the genes. Now, if we apply reversal to our genome, for reversing two genes C and D, we'll get this genome, and the corresponding graph would look like this. And we notice what happened, two black edges removed from a graph and two new black edges added that form matching the same for vertices. Same for fission, for fusion. Therefore, this leads to defining new operation on graphs, which replace any two black edges with another two black edges forming matching on the same four vertices. And it turns out that reversals, translocations, fissions, and fusions represent all different types of two breaks. We can define two break distance between two genomes as the minimal number of these operations required to transform one genome to the other. And it turns out that two break distance is much easier to compute, and I will show you just in a few slides how to do this. So suppose you have two genomes on the same set of blocks. This is the very same genome I already described, and genome Q on the same blocks, but the order direction of blocks are different. So one genome is represented as a black red graph, and the other genome is represented as green red graph. Red edges are labeled the same in the two graphs, but adjacencies are different. So black edges are different from green edges in the second graph. Now let me reorder red edges in the order defined by the second genome, and bring green edges. I will get what is called superposition of the two graphs, known under the name breakpoint graph. From now on, I will be interested only in black and green edges and, that represent respectively adjacencies in one genome and in the other genome. Both these edges form matching in the graph, perfect matching in the graph, so together they form a collection of cycles. It turns out that a number of cycles play an important role in computing two break distance between two genomes. Namely, if we consider transformation of one genome to the other, we will see that number of cycles, so this is optimal transformation, so number of cycles each time is increasing. And eventually, number of cycles become equal to number of genes in the genomes. So suppose you have transformation of genome P into genome Q with two breaks. It corresponds to transformation of breakpoint graphs and number of cycles. It changes from cycles of PQ in the original breakpoint graph to the number of cycles equal to number of blocks or genes in the genome. So increasing number of cycles is equal to difference between these two entities. So the question is how much each two break can contribute to this increase. It turns out that it cannot increase number of cycles by more than one. On the other hand, as soon as we have non-trivial cycle, we can break it into two, increasing number of cycles by one. So this observation lead to the simple formula for two break distance between two genomes, which is simply number of blocks minus number of cycles in the breakpoint graph. Now let us observe that the vertices of vertices that are for non-trivial cycles in the breakpoint graph correspond to what is called breakpoints, while vertices that are present in trivial cycles are formed up by just parallel edges, represent common adjacencies in the genomes. If you have particle transformation, we can count how many times each vertex is used by rearrangements. And eventually, for example, for this particular scenario, we have that this vertex was used once, this once, two times, zero, and zero times. So we have a number of uses, a number of reuses of the vertices. Now let me describe how we construct ancestral genomes. So we may be given, in the simplest case, we may be given a tree, and we're given a genomes at the leaves of this tree, and the question is to reconstruct genomes at the internal nodes of the tree. There exists a number of tools, including my own, which is the best, of course. Now, let me formalize the problem for distance-based method of reconstruction of ancestral genomes. So input is a set of K genomes and the phylogenetic tree. We need to produce genomes at the internal nodes of the tree, and the objective is to minimize the total sum of all genomic distances along branches of the tree. The problem is that in the simplest case, it is NP-complete. So, but in reality, what makes it problem hard is the breakpoint reuses. You may think of rearrangements as breakpoints as footprints of rearrangements on the ground of the genomes. And if ground is small and there are many rearrangements, it becomes messy, it's hard to trace them. However, if a lot of grounds, and we can easily trace the rearrangements. So my personal belief is that having many genomes simplifies the problem. So I'm not going to address the simplest case, I'm going to address the hardest case. So let me describe the MGRA algorithm. MGRA algorithm is based on observations from rearrangement analysis of two genomes and generalizes them to multiple genomes. It is problem driven. I'm not addressing the theoretical problem. I'm addressing practical instances of the problem. Therefore, all particular features are inspired by particular features we see in the breakpoint graphs of real genomes. So first question is how to generalize breakpoint graph for multiple genomes. Well, let me have now three genomes. We have the same blocks, so the red edges are the same in all three genomes. Adjacencies are different. Black edges encode adjacencies in P genome. Green edges encode adjacencies in Q genome, and blue edges encode adjacencies in R genome. Now we can bring them all together and construct what called multiple breakpoint graph of three genomes. We address particular problem reconstructing ancestor of six mammalian genomes, namely mouse, rat, dog, macaque, human, and chimpanzee. Please notice that this tree is not correlated with the time. It just gives the topology of the tree, but I do not claim about anything about timing of the ancestral genomes. So MGRA tries to convert all genomes into a single one, which is will be chosen arbitrarily. This is the real graph of six mammalian genomes. Pink vertices correspond to X chromosomes. And you see that this graph is not random. It's very well structured. You see many small cycles, in particular these guys here. You see long chains of vertices. So this gives hope that we can actually solve this problem. But question, what we need to do with this graph? In order to define how we deal with multiple breakpoint graph, let us take a different look on how we solve problem for two genomes. So if you have two genomes P and Q, we can transform one genome to the other, making two breaks in genome P, that two breaks on black edges, but we can transform genome Q into genome P, that make two breaks on green edges. In one case, we get genome breakpoint graph of the same genome Q and Q, and in the other case, we get a breakpoint graph of genome P and P. Now let us combine two ways. So let X be any genome on the shortest path between P and Q, then we can transform a P into X, by black two breaks, and we can transform Q into X by green two breaks. And this corresponds to a transformation of the breakpoint graphs. Moreover, important feature is that black and green two breaks in this transformation may arbitrarily alternate. So since they are independent of, they affect different objects. One affects black edges, the other affects green edges. This view easily generalizes to multiple genomes. So the problem is formulated as transforming the breakpoint graph of multiple genomes into breakpoint graph of the same genome X. Moreover, it's not actually important what is X. What is important that it is somewhere on the tree. And our requirement is that rearrangements are consistent with the given tree, and I explain in a moment what it means. Suppose we observe in our graph a cycle of this form. It's on four vertices. Between a pair of vertices, we have mouse and red edge, another mouse and red edge, and all four guys form the other vertices. How we can eliminate this cycle? And please notice that the goal is to eliminate the cycle since our target, the breakpoint graph of the same genome, has all cycles trivial. They must consist of parallel edges. So our goal is to make these all guys parallel. We can do two breaks, one in mouse, one in red. So we will create trivial multi-edge here and another trivial multi-edge here. We can do four breaks in these genomes, making trivial multi-edge here and trivial multi-edge here. Or we can make a single two break in the mouse red ancestor. But what it means? It means that we do two break simultaneously in mouse and red. You may think it is performing a single two break on these two edges at the same time, in these two edges at the same time. So this is an important feature of MGRA, that it is able to detect and perform rearrangement in ancestral genomes even before these rearrangement genomes are constructed. Even before these ancestral genomes are constructed. The question is, to what groups of genomes we can apply rearrangements at the same time? Well, this is actually dictated by the tree. For example, in this particular case, we can apply two breaks to mouse and red together, but not to mouse and human together, because mouse and human together have no interpretation in the given phylogenetic tree. Then all genomes are converged to a single genome, X. We can consider the reverse transformation, and this reverse transformation makes X to traverse the whole tree and define the genomes at the internal nodes of the tree. This way we were able to reconstruct ancestral genomes of six mammalian genomes. But the problem I actually would like to present today is related to gene deletions, and gene duplications. If you consider five genomes, then we may notice that the number of genes shared across the genomes drops dramatically. So between two genomes, we have this many, but if we consider five genomes, then the number of shared genes is roughly half of the amount for just two genomes. So all the tools that I described before, including MGRA, are limited to the case of genomes having equal gene content. So if I would solve problem for these five genes, I would need to consider only this portion of the genes and throw away a rather large amount of information. So it becomes important to incorporate gene duplications, gene deletions into the model. So how incorporate gene deletions and insertion in this framework, in MGRA framework? So if gene is present in all K input genomes, then the degree of corresponding vertices is just K. However, if gene is missing in some portion of the genomes, then the degree of corresponding vertices is less than K. We call such vertices unbalanced. MGRA balances the graph by creating what is called prosthetic chromosomes. And this is, two studies of transformation genomes with rearrangements and indels, but they limited just to two genomes. We generalize it to more than two genomes. So here's an example. Suppose gene V is missing in the blue genome. So the corresponding vertices in this case would have just a degree two, and the total number of genomes three, so all other vertices have degree three. We create an edge between them with dashed blue edge. And this way, we will make graph balanced. So we do a similar thing for all unbalanced vertices. Then the graph becomes subject to rearrangement analysis, which makes no distinction between regular and prosthetic edges. However, we treat rearrangement on prosthetic edges somewhat differently. Namely, we view these prosthetic edges as duck holes, which may supply edges for insertion or absorb edges being deleted. For example, if you have two break in blue edges on these two guys, which makes them this way, and if we interpret the resulting graph, you will see that in the original graph, in the original blue genome, we had blocks W and U, but in the resulting graph, we have blocks W, V, and U. So this is nothing else but insertion of the gene V in the blue genome. Similarly, if we perform green to break on these two guys and make one edge parallel to this prosthetic guy and the other here, then if we interpret the resulting genome, we will see that what happened is that the gene V got deleted from the green genome. So this way we model indels. Unfortunately, there exist not so many tools to compete with that are able to reconstruct ancestral genomes in presence of gene insertions and deletions. We were only of two such tools, PMAG Plus and GAP-AG. So we performed simulations. Namely, we simulated evolution of six genomes on 1,000 genes, and then the lengths of the branches were chosen from interval from 50 to 100 and from 100 to 200, and we considered different percentage of deletions. So results show that MGRA2 outperformed the other tools in with respect to accuracy of reconstructed adjacencies between genes in the ancestral genomes. MGRA2 is still under active development, and future goal is extending analysis to include gene duplications, as well as fine optimization, parallelization of MGRA2, and make it scalable to large number of genomes and large breakpoint graphs, and eventually make it available as a web service, which would require no technical skills to run it and get results. So I thank my students who are primary developers of MGRA2 and a National Science Foundation for the Career Award, which allows me to pursue this goal. Thank you.
Any questions?
It was a very interesting talk, and I was wondering if you could estimate how far in back in time your algorithm still reliably would work. For example, I guess you can do, for example, compare primates with each other, or primates to mouse, but could you do, like, for example, primates to platypus, or could you even go outside of the mammal group?
Well, on one side, this depends on how much common information we share, what would be the input to the problem. And other issue is the following. MGRA is multi-stage algorithm, and it uses exact algorithms as well as heuristics. And the user has control how much reliability he or she wants from the results. And depending on that, MGRA is able either to reconstruct whole ancestral genome or just conserved ancestral regions. So maybe if you want to be really sure that the results are reliable, you won't limit yourself just to CARs, okay. not whole genomes.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
One more question. I was just wondering if how do you simulate deletions and duplications in your 1,000 gene benchmark? Because obviously the rate of deletions will impact the difficulty.
Just randomly. So R stands for the percent of deletions, and the rest are rearrangements. So each time we basically see if we need to perform either rearrangement or deletion. If it is deletion, we just delete random.
And how do you decide on the rate of events?
Rate? Well, we just chose kind of.
Oh, yes, okay.
0, 20, 40, okay. And 60%.
Okay. I missed that, okay.
So, and you see that the quality somewhat drops as the percent of deletions increases. And the same for the other set of tests.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. Have many